Welcome to the Reschool'd podcast, the show that discusses all the things that schools may have missed, with your hosts, AJ Kuti and Jason Gordon. Everybody, welcome back to the show. We are the Reschool'd podcast, the show that discusses all the things that schools may not have prepared you for. I am AJ, and sitting across from me, Jason. Jason, how are you doing on this lovely morning?
I'm struggling, man. I'm struggling.
It's tough. Yeah, somehow morning. I think the germs went through the computer.
Yeah.
And what I had, you must be getting.
Yeah, those out there listening might know, or you might not. We are in different locations. We use software to record at the same time, and then, you know, we see each other on the screen and blah, blah, blah. But yep, AJ gave me a cold. So
yep.
That's, yep.
Yeah, it's that virus that comes across the computer, man.
Yeah.
What can you do?
These high quality, that's why they have these large lines on these microphones.
Mm-hmm.
You get some flow through there. So yeah, no, I'm woke up, got a cold. Actually, my 7-year-old brought this one home, so I'm blaming her. But yeah. But other than that, it's good. You know, colds are colds. You get over them.
Me too. It was my 7-year-old as well. There's something about them 7-year-olds, man.
Yep. Just that age where you still pick your nose.
Yep. Well, you know, in today's episode, we're going to continue on with this whole parent-student dynamic series. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we were talking about this before we started recording. It seems like there's a natural three-part series, mini-series within this. And, you know, last one we talked about was the academic expectations between parents and students. This one we're going to be talking about the personal expectations, so stuff outside of the academics, but not quite to the career yet. So this is almost like pre-career as well. And then the third one would naturally be the career expectations. So you think we're good on the personal side on this one?
Absolutely. Before we jump into it, though, remind everybody, visit us on the website. Check out our social media handles, and of course, give us some love on your favorite podcasting app. But a big thing about the website is not only can you see all our old episodes, right? They're all posted right there for you to go through, that type of thing. Search out the one that's of interest to you. Send us messages. That's the best way to reach us, so we know what you want to hear about. We all the time now, the majority of our episodes come from your questions or your inputs or things like that. So anyway, please hit us up on the website. That's Reschool with a D, not an ED. And yeah, we look forward to hearing from you.
Cool. Well, this episode is going to be, and the next one too, it's going to be kind of a rinse and repeat of the first one, because again, it's just looking at the expectations from a different perspective. So a lot of questions are going to be the same. We're just going to kind of answer them differently. So for the quick question, same as last one, is did your parents have personal expectations for you during college, and then rate those expectations, and then also when did you realize them?
See this is where I get to flip the coin 100%, I believe, because my parents didn't have a ton of academic expectations other than go ahead and try to graduate, which I did.
It's a big
so
one.
That worked out. And, you know, check the box on that one. But they had a lot of personal expectations in terms of how I comported myself and stuff like that, you know, and I think you'll see that with a lot of parents. They stay involved in your life in terms of your personal development, even if not your academic development. And so with that being said, they still wanted to make sure I was being a good person, that I wasn't getting in trouble, that, you know, I was, I can remember, well, I'll tell a story a little bit later, but I can remember one time that was when I called home, that was, it became quite the discussion to make certain I was, you know, living up and showing my appreciation for the scholarships I'd gotten. You know, they weren't as concerned about making the grades to keep it as they were of me making certain I did everything that the school wanted me to do in terms of showing my appreciation to the donors who funded the scholarships. And, you know, so it was just a lot more focus on that. So, and I think you get that kind of thing with parents a lot, right? They care who you become because, you know, you are in many ways a representation of them and the work they put into you. So yeah, it was pretty strong. What about you?
Yeah, I've said this before in other episodes. You know, the dynamic that I had my growing up in the house that I grew up in, my family and everything, you know, my dad came from a country where education's everything. He's got all the way through his postdoctorate. And then my mom, she graduated high school. And it was always this balance of grades, but also live, you know, live your life. And so there was expectations with my grades. And as long as those expectations were met in some capacity, then it moved towards the expectations of me just having fun. This is the golden years of your life. You don't have a whole lot of responsibilities. Kind of enjoy it. You find that balance, find that ability to have that fun, but at the same time, you know, do what is necessary. So there was that part. I agree with you where, you know, you say that there was, you know, the way you are, the person you are, the way you act is a representation of the way you grew up, the family behind you, that kind of thing. I do feel like there was a bit of a magnification on that in my situation, just because I went to the college my dad was the dean at. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there were people who saw me as a representation of him. I wasn't a big fan of that for obvious reasons. Because, you know, he had so many accolades. He's done so much. He's had so much success. And I didn't want people to see me as a reflection of him. At least the bad stuff. but you know, it was tough. It was hard because there was that expectation, and at the same time, they wanted me to have fun and go experience things. And when I say experience things, I'm also talking about make those mistakes. Now we're not talking about like absolutely, you know, life-changing mistakes, but make those mistakes where I learn from it. And then they helped me learn from it. I mean, they explained it to me. So, they did have expectations. They knew what they thought they knew. And then those expectations adapted kind of as I went through. You know, naturally I started, like I said, as a pre-med. So there was expectations there. When I changed, it was one of those things that, you know, it was a change for them. But with that change came with the change in expectations. So yeah, I think, you know, I realized those expectations fairly early on. Like I said, in my family, the expectations were brought up early and often. It was not like it was a secret. It wasn't like they were hidden cues and, you know, there were subtle hints. No, it was pretty much brought up like, here's what we expect of you. And from there, you make your own choices as to how to handle those expectations. And they also wanted me to have expectations for myself. So I appreciated the way in which they did that and kind of brought me up in that mindset.
Mm-hmm. Did you ever have any conflicts?
There was conflicts. And I wouldn't say it was conflicts. It was more of like, I remember times where like, I look back and I go, okay, what I was wanting to do didn't meet their expectations. And it wasn't like they would say, no, you can't do that because it's not part of our expectations and it's not really part of your expectations. But it was almost like they would ask me, okay, how can we make this match up to your expectations and their expectations? Like, how can we still do what you're wanting to do, whatever it may be, but still meet expectations, you know, here or there? So like, you know, I never had the curfew. Growing up in high school, I never had the curfew. And I mean, obviously I didn't have it in college, but they wanted me to experience things. They wanted me to go to have fun, go experience college parties, to see what it's like to be, because they knew me well enough to know I wasn't going to do anything really stupid. But there would also be times where you have tests. So you would have to figure out how to interweave this fun dynamic with the grades dynamic of their expectations. And it was that learning experience. It was those things. So were there conflicts? I would say that there was a bit of conflicts, but it turned more into a learning exercise of saying, okay, how can you get what you want, but we get what we want as well? It was never like a straight up no. It was just how can we work these things together? Mm-hmm. What about you? Did you have those situations?
Well, yeah, I guess in a way. there was, you know, I didn't have control exercise stove for me. And I think, you know, us being guys, we're not doing a great job of covering the gamut here because we do tend to have a little more autonomy early on in terms of the things we can do just by virtue of it's slightly less likely that someone is going to hurt us physically or try to take advantage of us sexually or something of that nature. It's far less likely. So there's this air of protection that goes in earlier in looking after young women rather than young men. And with that comes a little bit more liberation, a little bit higher degree of autonomy from your parents. So I never had the curfews, just like you. I was never policed in terms of did I go out drinking or anything like that. There was always the thing of, I mean, it would be really offensive to my parents if all the way through high school I didn't say yes, sir, or yes, ma'am to people who were older or significantly older. That is, you know, people, I guess when I was in high school, someone who was 10 years older deserved a yes, ma'am or yes, sir. Mm-hmm. That type of thing, and to be respectful, to show a lot of the Southern isms that we do, you know, the deferring to older people's opinions, not arguing, making certain there were certain topics you didn't talk about and things like that. Like, you know, you don't, as they say, and unless you're start down the same path, you don't talk about politics, sex, or religion, right? Yep. So things like that. I can count on one hand the number of times in my life I've said a curse word in front of my mother, right? That type of thing. It was just a level of expectations personally in terms of respect and the person you were putting out there type thing. And probably more so my father than my mother would definitely express their opinions if you weren't putting out that positive appearance and that type of thing. So there's all that, right? You know, not one time in my life till I was probably past 30 years old did I ever talk back to my father. And I can count on one hand the number of times I talk back to my mother. So there was a level of authoritarian type control over your demeanor and the amount of respect you show and stuff like that. And I know that's the opposite end of the spectrum from so many probably of our listeners out there who may not have had that at all, may have had absentee parents, right? Ones who were not involved at all, and they had an extreme level of autonomy. They had to grow up on their own very quickly, where I can't say I had that. I was allowed to develop in terms of studying and things like that, and I had a lot of trust in terms of the things that I did, but I still had a ton of nurturing when it came to how you live your daily life and the kind of a code of ethics automatically ingrained into you in that way. And I know a lot of people don't have that, right? You have to develop that on your own. And sometimes that comes from third parties in the environment. So I would say those people obviously face something that you and I didn't face. We had highly,
I agree with that. Yeah.
You know, highly present, highly nurturing families where that's a privilege. Not everyone has it, so.
Well, you know, they say, you know, if you look at the generations, the generations for us, like millennials, our parents tend to be those, if you look at it from the average, tend to be the helicopter parents. Whereas our generation of us being parents, we tend to back off that helicopter parents because we did have the helicopter parents and we didn't want to be like them. That's usually the argument that happens is we don't want to be like our parents because our parents were so overbearing on us. And I agree. I looking at that statement, I can't agree with that because I looking back at the way I grew up, I'm so happy that I grew up the way I did because it made me the person I am today with the respectful side, with the, you know, the understanding, allowing for mistakes to be made. I'm not going to control my kids I'm not going to, but there is that level that I still want to protect them. And you're right when you're talking about, you know, we're looking at it from the male perspective, whereas my mom told me many times, had I been born a female, I wouldn't have not had the same openness to do things as I had, simply because of a protection mentality. Like you said, the tendencies. I have a stepson and I have two girls, and there are some leniencies that my son has that my girls probably won't have right away. And a lot of it has to do with, you know, I have to teach him. I mean, I guess I shouldn't say have to, but I want to teach him how to be respectful to females, and I want him to be respectful to, you know, older people. And I'm going to teach my girls that too, but I also have to protect them from people who may not have had that teaching. And that's the fearful part.
And, you know, not to say, you know, to be on equal footing here, not to say that boys deserve or need more autonomy than women. Honestly, they probably need it because we're so immature and we grow up so much slower in terms of our development.
I'm still so immature.
In a perfect world, you'd be able to allow your daughters the full extent of that autonomy as well. It's just because the world just doesn't function the way it should, there are so many guys out there who honestly seek to take advantage of females. I mean, even encourage scenarios or situations where they can be taken advantage of by buying them the drinks, by offering them drugs, by, you know, that type of thing. And then, of course, the physical stature thing, the ability to protect yourself, you know, comes into play as well. So anyway, so to the extent we can talk to this, for those out there listening, it's not that we don't fully recognize or appreciate the difference. I mean, I've got two girls. AJ, you've got two girls. And I saw, you know, in my wife, she had probably the most involved mother, not father, but you know, the father was always there and always supportive and stuff, but you know, it was just the most extreme helicopter type scenario. It was hours worth of conversations a day all the way up, you know, from high school into college, and you know, she knew every teacher, every professor, every assignment, it was just a level of, it was almost living life vicariously through someone else, right? But still wanted to be the authority, right? And exercise control. And if you care that much and you want to be invited in, that's one thing, but it becomes, and I guess that's the real genesis of problems, when parents want to make certain that their children are developing, that they're put in the best scenarios, that they aren't harmed by others and things like that, and they insert themselves into their kids' lives, there's a fine line there from being a voice of reason and simply an influence in the life, right? Someone who's there to support, and someone who tries to control someone else's life to meet your expectations. And I think that's where you get most of the tension between the kid and the parent as they're growing up, or the young adult and the parent, is because at what point are you autonomous and what point is it up to you? And the parent can still be there as a voice of reason or some level of influence, but to attempt in any way to exercise control, at what point does that become terribly unhealthy or unwelcome, or honestly is the genesis of conflict between the two, right? So, I mean, yeah.
Well, let's get into go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, so anyway, I think that's the question there that everybody has to answer for themselves. Like, how do you manage that relationship if you have any of these, right? If you're like us, you might have the perfect scenario or close to it. If you have too little parent involvement and you actually seek more, how do you handle that relationship with the parent? And then the more common, I would say, scenario these days, especially with this generation that we grew up under, our parents, that they want to be more involved and in many cases controlling than ever. How do you deal with that?
Yeah. Well, and that's what I was going to say. Let's get kind of into the crux of it then, because, you know, the main question we had last time was how can parents' expectations be valuable to students during college, and how can they be detrimental? So again, we're looking at it from the personal side of it, and it really, you know, it kind of dropped in our laps last time. It's really a spectrum, you know. Mm-hmm. It's kind of the whole, you know, Goldilocks. You know, there is a level of expectation where you don't want too little and you don't want too much. You just want that just right to be impactful and to be helpful to the student. If you have too much or too little, then it can start to wear away. So let's look at, you know, what is that baby bear level where it's just perfect? So how can it be valuable to students? And then how can too much of it or too little of it be detrimental?
That's a good question. So one, you can stifle development. And two, you know, your over-involvement type thing on one extreme. And on the other side, you don't stifle it, but you don't allow, you don't aid in development.
Yep.
Right? At the other end of the stream, because having seen things, right? Parents, they've been around for a while. They've been through generations change, technology changes, social media changes,
that's a
attitudes,
big one.
Right? I mean, everything changes. So parents can't expect to stay up on that. They can't expect to fully understand what their kids are going through, right? But the things that they have seen, right? They can relay those messages. Even if they don't seem like they're heard, they are heard in a way, right? They can be that support. They can be that encouragement. They can be that voice of reason. They can, in some cases, be the authoritarian that controls the scenario. And that's part of growing up. And, you know, any of that can be used to the extreme. So if you don't have that, right, I mean, again, do you fully develop as a person if your parents don't force that level of respect and self-respect and discipline and motivation and all of those things on you? On the opposite extreme, if your parents do too much for you, if they force things down on you and it's not yours, there's a natural tendency there to never claim ownership, right? To never feel accountable, to never feel like you're living your own life. And honestly, that can be just as detrimental. Right. I mean, if you want to know why such a high percentage of youth these days are in therapy, there's a good amount of research out there that shows the excessive level of parental involvement in the child's development is a contributing factor, because 9 times out of 10, what you're hearing in some of those sessions revolve around level of parental involvement and control.
Yeah, my big thing, you'd mentioned it, like with social media, you know, that was our generation's, really, it's a turning point for our generation, because we grew up without it and now we have it. So we saw both sides. Same mm-hmm. thing with technology, really, too. But that really kind of blew up for us in our heyday. And so with my kids, especially my son, who's 18. It's one of those things where he came to us at a younger age and was like, hey, can I get social media? And there was a part of us that was like, no, we want to protect you from what comes from social media. And there's a lot of negative stuff that comes from social media. I mean, there's plenty mm-hmm. of studies that talk about that. And we wanted to protect him. And mm-hmm. then the more and more we talked about it, the more we were on the same mind. When I say we, my wife and I, we were on the same mindset that we want to protect him, but at the same time, we're not going to protect him for the rest of his life. There will be a time when he will be on his own. And I would much rather help him develop the understanding of what social media is while he's here. And then when he goes out on his own, I don't have to worry about it as much. Mm-hmm. And granted, there's a lot of fear that can come from stuff like that. But at the same time, there is a level of trust that also has to come from it. And I am able to help guide him through things while he's here versus if we never gave him the ability to, and then he got out on his own and didn't even know how to protect himself. So that's why we were like, okay, we're going to do this. We're going to do it. I mean, we're going to ease into it. We're not going to just go full, you know, full blast in it, but we're going to ease into it and kind of help guide him through that, but not restrict it to the point where, you know, we're that helicopter parent. That was, I guess you'd say that was an expectation of his that we worked with, to kind of help guide our expectation. And I agree, like, you know, you can, there's a lot of, obviously growing up, and I think, again, we're going back to this, the thing that we had talked about earlier, whereas, you know, males tend to mature at a lot slower pace than females. I'm a prime example of that. And I think, you know,
still hadn't grown up, AJ.
I'm not going to. I'm not planning on it. I'm going to grow old. That's about it because it's mandatory. But
Peter Pan syndrome.
Yeah, absolutely. And I do have expectations for him. But I also, it's almost like if I look at it as I have expectations, but I also have a safety net. Like I also understand that he will make mistakes. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to, you know, I'm not going to be the person that chastises him for every single mistake that he makes. I mean, I remember him coming home one day from school and he had a scar on his hand, like a scab on the top of his hand. And I'm like, my wife she asked him something and he was like, oh, it's because of this. And I told her, I said, it is not what he said it was. I can guarantee you without a shadow of a doubt, it is not what that is. Because I know what that was because I did it. I was stupid enough to do it as well. And it was that whole eraser challenge where you take the eraser and you scrub it as many times as you can until you can't do it anymore. It was it was stupid, middle school stupidity. Yeah. But I told him in the car, I was like, okay, so how'd you get that scar? And he told me, and I said, you want to try it again? And one of the things for me, my expectation is you never lie and you never steal. Mm-hmm. That's two mm-hmm. major expectations for any of my kids. That's how I grew up. And so I said, you want to try that again? Because I know what it is. And then he finally broke down and he told me, I said, and I told him, I don't care that you did it. Is it stupid? Absolutely. 100%. But did I do it? Yes, absolutely. I did it. 100%. And I said, there are going to be these stupid challenges that come out that, you know, you're in middle school and it's going to be you trying to prove that you're the man kind of thing. You're your strength and everything. And it come to me. All I asked him is he came to me and say, is this something that I can do? And I told him, I said, I don't care how stupid it is. You can do it if you want to, but I worry about the health side of it because, like, you know, that's not going to do that much. I mean, it's going to give you a scar on your hand potentially, but like the whole cinnamon challenge, that has health repercussions. That could really actually harm you.
Yes, that is terrible.
And so, like I told him, I said, there's a difference between the two and I'll let you be stupid. I'll let you be young and stupid. Just come to me and ask, is it okay? Am I going to be safe for doing this? Because there are some that are not safe and I don't want you to have to go through that. So, you know, that was kind of an expectation that we laid, you know, early on. But, you know, going back to the question, you know, where is that sweet spot? There are a lot of things outside. And when we say personal, we mean, you know, anything outside of academia. There are a lot of other expectations that I think we haven't even touched on yet that could present problems depending on the level in which the expectations are pushed. One of them to me that I've found is, you know, you have parents that they want their child to find a spouse, get married quick so they can go ahead and start their life. Mm-hmm. You know, that's one that can be very, very problematic. Because you never know what without talking to someone and without believing what you talked about with that person, if you have this mentality of I know better than you, then it could be really problematic because that person may be more career focused. And then the spousal side of it may come later. Or maybe it's just not on their wheelhouse. Maybe they're very focused on their career and they don't feel like they want to have to be with somebody in that capacity. You also have people who are very, you know, you have parents that are very, I find these to be even more kind of pushy, I guess, if you would say, is the sports parents.
Oh my gosh.
Yes. I mean, you talk about the sports side of things. If you're talking about a parent, especially typically it's going to be your dad. If your dad's been a coach for you since you were little, they're going to have these super high expectations for you. And if you make it to college ball, then they get even higher. And that could be a problem because it gets, again, too overbearing. And you have to figure out kind of
in a lot of realms, you know, yeah, not just the absolutely. Sports, but the music, the dance. Yeah. Hey, it tends to be club based stuff, right?
Like, yeah, of course.
Affinity based stuff. But yeah, I see it the same way. Parents get so in, you know, and it comes down to, again, one of those things about wanting the best for your kid, but wanting your life for your kids, right? Did you see that most recent Disney cartoon? What's the name of it? It was recently released. It's
remember what it was about.
I don't want to give the entire plot line, but it's basically where they are in this world where there's this plant that gives them power and stuff.
Oh, Encanto.
No. The father is an explorer. No. Let me.
I don't know.
Let me Google it.
That one. I don't know.
So, let me see.
I haven't even watched it yet.
The most recent release.
It sounds interesting. Yeah.
Let's see.
But no, you know, going back to what you're saying, while you're looking this, you know,
Strange World.
I haven't seen that one. No, I haven't seen that
one. Well, it's really good, and the entire premise behind it is the fact that sometimes parents put so much pressure on their kids to have the same life or the life that they expect or the life that they want for them. And, you know, if you do it early enough on, you introduce your kids to the sport or the dance or the music or whatever, and you put so much emphasis on it, you care so much about it, it makes them care about it. It does. Yeah. So you influence them to be, you know, what you think they can be. But once again, what you think they can be is related to what you in a way want them to be, yeah. Right? And because anybody can be anything, right? So there's this fine line of supporting, being, being a facilitator in that versus putting too much pressure and the expectations overcoming, right? My little girls love High School Musical. Do you remember that with?
Oh yeah,
Zac
Efron.
Yeah, Zac Efron. It was a great show.
Corbin Blue.
I think there was a series of them, but yeah. You know, one of the main things in there was expectations of parents and how, you know, oftentimes they conflict with the expectations of the kids, right? So it's something that's ubiquitous across all these shows, these programs, you know, daily life and things, and that's the reason they make movies about it, because there is this level of parental involvement, of parental control that needs to be understood and managed, right? And like everything else, just like I talk to my students about when we discuss discrimination and stuff like that, one of the biggest things you can do is just create awareness, right, that it's happening. And that's the first step of stopping it, or at least mitigating the effects of it, is to be aware. And in this case, be aware on both sides, parent and child, right? That, okay, this isn't really okay. This needs to be, once again, a child-driven situation, or parent, you need to be better and be more involved, or whatever, right? Where whatever end of the spectrum you fall on.
So our next question, which is the same one we talked about last episode, I think the answer is going to be the same, which is how to handle the relationship from the student and the parent's perspective. And the answer here and the answer there was to communicate, being able to have this open dialogue to get both sides to understand what each side's expectations are, and then how they can kind of merge those together to come to some kind of symbiosis. And I don't think that's going to change here. I do have a separate question for you, though, because I do feel like there's a part of this from a parental side that is important to discuss, but it also is important to, like you said, get it out there to the student, because essentially they're probably going to be the ones who listen to this, maybe. Get it out there to the student so they can understand the other side. And that is, how do you handle, because you talked about sports, we talked about relationships, we talked about, you know, those kind of things, maybe career, whatnot. But how do you handle, from a parent's perspective, this feeling of you want your kid to be content, you want your kid to be successful in terms of their mind and your knowledge. And by that, I mean, you know that there's no way that this, they're going to be able to make a career out of, you know, sitting and watching TV all day, or it's very slim. Mm-hmm. And they're not going to be able to sustain financially if they follow that track. How do you balance that with letting them live? So mm-hmm. for instance, if my child wants to play sports, then I want to support them. And at the same time, if I feel like that sports is one, they're content with the sports, they're having fun with the sports, it's still fun to them. It could also lead to maybe a scholarship in college, so I want them to do the best, but maybe they're not mature enough to understand that yet, because they have now, they get into high school and they have friends, and their friends may not play sports and they want to go to different, you know, events, so they want to go hang out or whatever, and it takes away from maybe what would be practices for the team. How can you balance that from a parent's perspective to, you know, those both sides?
Yeah. You know, I don't think there is a good answer. Yeah. I think you can always, the best you can be is the voice of reason, right? Sure. They're explaining your take on why this is valuable, that type of thing. Not facilitating negative conduct. That's one of the big ones. I mean, lots of times parents will preach one thing and then give their kids everything, right? Mm-hmm. There's something about positive reinforcement. Sure, I will pay you allowance. I will put gas in the vehicle and let you drive. I will do these things, especially parents who are able to buy their kids a vehicle and stuff like that.
Sure.
You know, if conduct isn't that what you expect, if motivation and involvement, I mean, rewarding kids for performing well in stuff, something like making good grades, like participating in sports. And that was one thing I will definitely, you know, I always be thankful about with my parents. While I did work during the summers and would do a little bit of work during the year, and I always worked on the farm helping my parents, but as far as like getting a job and making money, they fully still supported me. They put gas in the vehicle I got to, you know, got to drive around in and stuff. And you know, gave me some money to, you know, use and eat and do things, you know, just going out and doing fun things that I didn't have to earn, right? That, you know, and perhaps I did helping around the house and stuff like that, helping around the farm. I did, you know, in a way, you know, but there was a trade-off. If I didn't help, or if I was lazy and I didn't get up in the morning to help feed cows, or if I didn't help, you know, maintain, you know, there's a lot of grass to cut around a farm, you know, mm-hmm. if I didn't do those things, then perhaps they wouldn't have given me a vehicle to ride around in it or pay for my gas. They wouldn't have. And, you know, then I would have had to go get a job. Right. Yeah. So, and to the extent that I didn't help with those things, I think they should have taken away those things. Yeah. Luckily, they just kept reinforcing it that we'll give you these things and we'll support you in that way as long as you act like a good person. They wanted me to make decent grades, but that was never like the real metric. It was more about yeah. being just a good person and or what they saw as a good person, right? The yes sirs, the yes ma'ams, never steal, never lie, that type of stuff. And as long as you did that and I was helpful around the home, then yeah, I mean, that was it. But yeah, I had people I grew up with. One guy in particular, I grew up with him my entire life, and he got everything he ever wanted. I mean, he was spoiled, just absolutely rotten. And he was such a troublemaker in school. And he, at times, was a bully. He was just so many negative characteristics that he had. You know, mm-hmm. hate to say that I hung around with him very much, but, you know, even then I recognized it, sure. Right? And it was largely because his parents, he had the most involved parents, like in terms of his like daily life, and just he never did anything wrong. Everything was, you know, he got anything he wanted and type stuff, and that's kind of what made him rotten. And yeah. You know, he's, I think he's doing okay now, but he never really amounted to too much professionally, just by virtue of, you know, the world wasn't again handed to him. I think his parents had to support him till he was in his 30s, right? Yeah. And so anyway, point being is that type of scenario, that's an extreme, right? Where parents are just, they don't use whatever level of influence they have as positive reinforcement, and, you know, taking the negative reinforcement, which is, you know, taking away the positive reinforcement, meaning that you don't get these things. You don't get your own car. You don't get all these new nice things. You don't get to have money and spend all day at the country club, right? Because that was kind of his thing, right? Big golfer. You don't get to do these things if you don't live up to a certain level of our expectations. And he definitely didn't live up to those expectations for the most part in terms of his how he handled himself around others in school and things like that. So anyway, extreme example, but we've all know that person. We've all seen that person. And, you know, that's one extreme. And then again, on the other end, the parent who's not involved in enough, you can't depend 100% on a person being self-motivated, right? Sometimes the lack of involvement, especially when you have your basic needs met, sometimes breeds a lack of direction, a lack of drive, right? People feel lost. Like, you don't have that, at least the appearance of the straight and narrow to follow, right? You have to make your own way without a good source of influence and having that positive influence there in your life. And, you know, I know kids who don't have both parents in the household oftentimes face such a difficult climb, right? Because mm-hmm. there's only so much one parent can do, right? Yeah. You know, you can be amazing, but still it helps to have two people to share the load that otherwise one person has to bear. So anyway, you know, I bring that up just because I think it's important for us, yeah. you know, talking through this, to recognize everybody's got a different scenario. Everybody faces a different hurdle. It's not an easy thing for the parents by any means. You know, like you keep saying, or your mother kept saying, kids don't come with instruction manuals, right?
No, yeah, we're still learning.
And so anyway, we all are, and we probably always will be. But to the extent possible, you do want to set your kid up for long-term contentment. You want to certainly, if you can, give them moments of happiness. Both of those tend to relate to giving them something to accomplish and something to work towards. If the things that you model for them to try to accomplish and to work towards are valuable to you, make certain they're also valuable generally to society. But also early on, when you introduce them and when you try to reinforce them, just make certain they are of value again to your child. And mm-hmm. if you do, you know, that's going to build a stronger relationship between you, of course, and the child. But, you know, you're going to do the best for them you can in terms of their personal development. And you'll float somewhere in that middle and not be one of the extremes, right?
Sure. So, you know, you brought up a good point, and I think I'll kind of close it out here. But I think the best way to just recap what you said is, if you want to find that balance from a parent's perspective, you need to be supportive but not be an enabler.
Mm-hmm.
You know, using the example that you're using, it seemed like the parents were an enabler for those bad qualities, which grew mm-hmm. and grew and grew until they were 30. And like for me, I joke around with my son. I was like, okay, when you're 18, you're out. I don't mean that. I'm just joking around. I don't care if he lives, you know, with us until he can get off his feet and start his life. I'm not going to enable any bad habits, and I'm not going to just give things away to him. But if he's working hard and working towards something, I don't have a problem at all supporting him through that journey to the best of my ability, obviously. And so, yeah, I think it's a matter of being supportive, but not enabling. So that's what I'll.
Yeah, I think that's well said. Well, to the extent of our limited understanding of this topic, you know, we're in a scenario where we only like know what we've experienced, right?
Yeah.
But happy to share that. Hopefully that helps a little bit, because this is certainly part of that, what they did not teach you in school type scenario.
For sure. Well, hopefully you got something out of this. So I've enjoyed it. I'm actually really enjoying this series, this little mini series that we're doing. But you got any parting words to say before we head out?
Just to remind everybody, our website. It's great. Check it out. All the episodes, contact us, you know, whatever. And of course, all the love on the social media handles and all the love on the podcasting app platforms, where you give us all the stars and the likes and the comments and the shares and the applauds and whatever else you can give us there. We'll take it all. Give us everything you got.
Anything.
No charge. Just the free stuff. Give us the free stuff.
Yeah. No, you don't spend any money on us. It's free. Well, we hope you enjoyed the show. Hope to see you next time. Until then, goodbye.
Take care.
Thanks for listening to the Reschool'd podcast. Be sure to head over to Reschool'd.com for news and other information on things we're getting into.